Oh, I've gotten exposed to so much Canadian culture this week that by the time I'm done filming, you'll probably find me sitting on my Chesterfield wearing nothing but my gitch, eating a plate of poutine and drinking a bag of milk. This filming has been brutal. But the videos are going to be beauty, eh? Greetings, one and all, and welcome to the grand finale of Canada Week here on Tom's Hit Parade. Yes, this has been my week-long celebration of my favorite music from the land above the 49th parallel, the great nation of Canada. Yes, this I've been loving Canadian music. It's held a special place in my heart for 20 years or so now, and so this has been a long time coming. I've wanted to do this week-long video tribute to Canada for quite a while. And I hope it's turned out well to meet your satisfaction. I hope you've been enjoying watching it as much as fun as I've had filming it. And I, first of all, before I get started, I want to thank everybody who's been watching it and supporting it, and especially my two YouTube friends, Ryan of True North Reviews and Shayok from The Quotable Shayok, for their great contributions to my collaboration episode installment of Canada Week. And also I want to thank all of the great Canadian artists that I've been talking about all week long for the great music that they have decorated my ears with. Maybe I could phrase that differently, but anyway, I'm tired. I've been filming for a while now, so. But anyway, yes, yesterday I was talking about the bottom 10 of my top 13 favorite Canadian albums of all time, and I decided to save the top 3 on that list for a separate video for today, just because I thought that I think I have enough to say about each of them that it's going to warrant this separate video. But also because I was having trouble thinking of a fifth topic to round out the 5 days of Canada Week, so it worked out nicely, I think. But anyway, let's without further ado, let's just plunge right on in, and starting with my number 3 favorite Canadian album of all time, it is We Were Born in a Flame by the Sam Roberts Band, or Sam Roberts. They were actually billed in both ways on different releases of this album, We Were Born in a Flame. It's a fantastic album, and I have a bit of a complicated history with it, interestingly. This was Sam Roberts' first album, and a long, long time ago I bought it on CD, and it just didn't strike me really well at that point. That was where I was, at the point where I was just kind of obsessed with Canadian music. I was just kind of putting my feelers out there, so whenever I heard that an artist was Canadian that I hadn't heard of, I went out and picked up their CD when I could find it. And so at that point, my ears weren't ready for it at that point, I guess you could say. So I actually ended up trading the CD in, and at some other point years later, I happened upon this record, this album of it. It's actually a 2-LP set. Again, I gave it another listen, and I thought it was okay, but at that point, I was not much into vinyl, so yes, I ended up selling this record to a store at some point. But fast forward several years after that, I found the CD in a bargain section, I'm pretty sure it was, for $3, or it might have even been in the $1 section. Picked it up again, and that's when it clicked with me. It was 3 or 4 years ago, I think it was. It just absolutely clicked. I loved every single song on this album. It was the right time for me to hear it, I guess. And this is just great heartland rock. I don't know if Canada has a heartland. If he weren't Canadian, I would call this Americana music, but I guess it's Canadiana. North Americana. Let's put it that way. But yes, just some great stuff like you'd hear from John Mellencamp, or possibly a less rocky Bruce Springsteen, maybe. But yeah, it's just, I mean, one song after another on here is great. It opens up with 4 fantastic songs. Hard Road is good. Where Have All the Good People Gone? That was one of the singles off this album. That's just fantastic. The song that any of you out there would have been most likely to have heard, at least especially on American radio, would have been Brother Down. That was one of the big, probably the big single, that the one that was most promoted here in the States, as I said. This album, I think, made more of an impact in Canada than it did here in the States. But yeah, that would have been the song that most Americans would have been exposed to. Higher Learning, the song right after that, is another great song. I mean, this album is just absolutely packed end to end. Don't Walk Away, Eileen is another excellent song. Every Part of Me, that one has a great, a Simon and Garfunkel sort of a shuffling kind of beat to it. But, I mean, yeah, as I've said a couple of times already, probably, just every single song on here is just great. If you like that semi-folkish rock type of stuff with a little bit of country, just a little bit of country and maybe a little bit of blues in it as well, you cannot go wrong with Sam Roberts. We Were Born in a Flame. He's put out several albums since then, and I have not yet gotten around to picking up any of them or really listening to them. But I absolutely need to do that. This is just a fantastic album. No wonder. I mean, it's my number three favorite album from Canada of all time. So yes, if you're so inclined, give a listen to Sam Roberts. I don't think you'll regret it. It's just fantastic. A fantastic album from front to back. Wonderful. And now my runner-up for favorite Canadian album of all time. This is going to be where it's going to get a little weird, because with the singer-songwriter authenticity artistry of Sam Roberts, we're moving into some decidedly much more ear candy stuff. Not the saccharine teen popish sort of ear candy, but definitely further in that direction. I mentioned this artist, I think, in my favorite artists countdown a couple of days ago. This is the, unfortunately, final album by Canadian duo 121. It's called Imagine It, and this one was actually, I think, the only one of their albums to be released in the States here. It was released on A&M Records back in 1991, I think? 92. So yeah, it had a modest success here in the States. One reason that they didn't record a follow-up was because it was modest success. But honestly, this album is a not-so-guilty pleasure for me. From front to back, I mean, every single song on here. Peace of Mind, Love Goes On, that was the modest radio hit that we heard here in the States. I mean, every single song is just, I practically know these songs by heart. I've listened to this album so much, especially from, you know, back in the early 90s when it was fresh out of the gate. Memory Lane, Keeping Faith, Friends, Big on Emotion. Big on Emotion is a great song. It had some rock elements. That's the song that probably had the most rock elements of any of the songs on here. The rest of them were more or less pop. But yeah, Big on Emotion had almost a Melissa Etheridge sort of a feel to it. It just kind of had... And Gypsy Girl was another one that was very, very much like that. Very earthy and southern rocky, kind of bluesy sort of stuff. But, you know, in as much as pop music can go in that direction, you know, it's not full-on blues rock like Janis Joplin or anything, but definitely in that direction from where the rest of the album goes. But a fantastic album. I love that album so much that I actually, over the years, have picked up their first two albums, Forward Your Emotions, which was their first album from 1985, and their self-titled 121 album from 1988. You saw this one in my favorite artist's countdown. But yeah, and these two were much more synth pop driven than this album. This album has much more what I call organic instrumentation, like actual guitars, both acoustic and electric, and that kind of stuff. So and real drums as opposed to synth drums, as these albums have. But yeah, and that's one reason why these guys were amongst my favorite artists. Is, you know, I've got all three of their albums. They're all wonderful to varying degrees, but this by far is my absolute favorite of their albums. Imagine It by 121, my second favorite Canadian album of all time. Okay, this is it. The moment you've been waiting for. On Pins and Needles, are you ready? My favorite Canadian album of all time. And this is going to be a bit of a head-scratcher, kind of like 121 was, but for reasons I'll explain in a minute. But yes, this was another artist that was on my favorite album, my favorite artist's countdown, as was most of the ones on my favorite albums list. But anyway, yes, without further ado, this is unfortunately the last album from Canadian brother act The Moffats. It is called Submodalities, and it is my favorite Canadian album of all time. For a while, this was actually ranked as my favorite album of all time, Canadian or otherwise, but it's been a while. I'm not sure if it still is or not. It's been quite a while since I have reevaluated my top favorite albums of all time, so this may not necessarily be number one still, but it is definitely in, most likely still in my top five. But yeah, this was, very few people have heard of this album. A few of you, especially in Canada, may know who the Moffats are from years back. This was, as I said, their last album. But most of you people probably know who the producer was. The producer of this album was Bob Rock. Bob Rock, who produced Metallica and also Michael Bublé, an odd, diametric opposite artist that Bob Rock has produced. But anyway, yes, Bob Rock produced this album, and this was their final album. Partly because the guys were starting to experience creative differences. This album, in a way, suffers from that because the songs, and this is one reason why a lot of you probably would not be taken with this album, at least nearly not to the degree that I have been, is that the songs on this album are kind of not disjointed, but they don't interconnect well. So it's not a cohesive listen, is basically what it is. It's still, in my opinion, a good listen, an entertaining listen. It's just, it sounds more like a compilation album than a cohesive artist work, you know, a cohesive album. That's the only reason why this album suffers, and it's, you know, kind of, as I said, the creative differences that had started to appear between the guys. They each wanted to go in a different direction with the music, as would be evident when you hear this album. And they of course each take part in the songwriting as well. And this was also, though, the first album. Their previous album is the one that I showed in my favorite artist countdown, Chapter One, A New Beginning. That was their first pop rock album after the Country Days, but that was much more of an ear candy, teen pop oriented album. This was the first album where they really wanted to be taken seriously as artists. The lyrics cover much more mature themes. It's a more adult sounding rock album. I mean, there's a song on here that smacks of kind of Radiohead sort of a sound, and Antifreeze and Aeroplanes, that's that song. And there's a song that has kind of a punk pop edge, kind of like Green Day or Blink 182. That song is California. But there are also some radio-friendly songs that were groomed for radio play, like Bang Bang Boom, which is very catchy, but yes, it was much more of a radio hit. That was one of their singles, as well as Always in My Heart was probably the least interesting song on here. It was a ballad that was, compared to the rest of the album, a relatively ordinary-sounding ballad. But, I mean, so many of the other songs. Life on Mars Here comes my sitar fetish that works into this. Life on Mars features a sitar. It's a very 60s psychedelic sounding rock song. It's one of the standouts. It is not a cover of the David Bowie song, by the way. It's a different song. Call the Doctor is the next to last track on here, and that's... don't know who that would remind me of, but a song called Walking Behind is on here. Very, very clever lyrics. Probably the most lyrically clever song on the album, and that kind of has a Paul Simon syncopation shuffling kind of rhythm to it. And another song called Typical, which is one of the other standout rock type songs on here. It's just masterfully put together. But anyway, as you can see, I cannot say enough good things about this album, you know, except for, as I said, the one drawback of it, its one weakness would be the rather disjointed sound it has from one song to the next. I loved it so much that being unavailable as a domestic release in the U.S., I had to order it from, I think it was from HMV when they had stores in Canada. I don't think they have stores up there anymore, unless I'm wrong. I pre-ordered it, and we pre-ordered it early enough that I was able to get an autographed insert, which is a cool extra. So, it's one of the albums that I treasure, and to this day, I still hate the fact that the band didn't survive to do a follow-up album. They went their separate ways after this. It's been long enough since I've been kept up on the Moffat stuff that I'm starting to forget their names. The twins, Clint and Bob, went on to form a couple of other bands of various types, a rock band called Hidel, and a pop, more of a pop, synth-pop oriented band called Same Same, which was popular in Southeast Asia. But yeah, this was, in my opinion, the Moffat's crowning achievement, a fantastic, fantastic album. Listen to it if you haven't yet, and just, you know, keep in mind the expectation that it's going to sound not well interconnected from one song to the next, but the songs individually in and of themselves, in my opinion, are some of the best songs out there that have ever come out of Canada. Wonderful album, Submodalities by the Moffats, my favorite Canadian album of all time. So I hope this was a worthwhile and entertaining finale to this cross-Canadian journey of my favorite music from the land of Canada. Some of it's stuff that I've been wanting to talk to you guys about for a long time. I've loved it for years and years and years, and it's stuff that I don't think got the attention it deserved at the time of its release, or especially outside of its native Canada. Are there any favorite Canadian artists that I didn't mention that you really enjoy, some that us Americans may not have heard of? Lay them on me down in the comments section. I'd love to hear about them. I'm always up for exploring more music. The odder the better, at least in terms of their sphere of awareness, at least. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed it. That's it for this video, and that's it for Canada Week. I hope you enjoyed it. Suggestions, questions, constructive criticisms, lay them on me in the comments section below. Also, scroll down to the description for the link to my Twitter feed and links to my favorite fellow YouTubers who are all worth checking out. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel and browse my past videos, and be sure to ring that notifications bell so you'll be the first to know each time I drop a new video. Otherwise, thank you so much for watching, I'll see you next time, and remember, Life's too short to be a music snob, eh?